Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm starting a new series of videos where I'm going to show you how to deploy applications to Google Cloud. And this is the first part where we are just simply create a virtual machine, where the application is going to run, and then I will show you some key configurations that you probably need to know how to do it, and then on also how to set up the gCloud CLI in your machine. Today we will see how to do it in a Linux client, and also later on how to access this new VM using SSH, either just to connect remotely to the user interface, to the CLI of this new VM using SSH, or also how to transfer data with a client from Windows like FileZilla or something similar that you may want to use. So first of all, we go to our Google Cloud dashboard. I suppose that you already had this done. You had your project created, your service account created, and that is a requirement to do this video. And so you can, to create the VM, you just go to Compute Engine, a virtual instance, and you get this page. As you can see, I already had one. Click on Create Instance. You will get a name. You can provide here a name, a region. Here, this just a note to remind you that be careful when you where you create the machine. Try, if you are planning to access some data, deploy data that is going to be in a bucket in the case of Google or some other service, be aware of the placing the machine on a closed region, and or be aware of that you may incur in short expenses for data crossing the borders of different regions. So this is a topic that you always need to consider at the time that you create resources in Google Cloud, or in any other cloud provider is exactly the same. So there is, well, you need some planning before start to deploy services without any control, because it's not again, you can get a very high fee case that you are accessing to data that is located in different regions, especially in regions that are in different continents. No, this is really extremely expensive, so try to keep an eye on that. So then on, you choose the configuration. In this case, we are going to choose the cheapest one. It's just a try, but in my case, the one I choose as well is one of the smaller, because I don't need a big server. The application is gonna be running a fast API server with Unicorn and an extremely application, so it's not going to be very big. In any case, you can change this later on once the machine has been deployed, and then it's not a big issue. You just need to, in some cases, shut down the machine. In other cases, you can do it. You can do a hot change, being the machine running, so it's not a big issue. So you have here different templates. Try to choose what is more convenient for your necessities. You can the type of machine as well. You can configure a preset. It's just you taking a default template, or just you can customize whatever you want to do. You want to have inside the possibilities of that series. I just shoot the default one. This later on I will delete it, so no, not a problem. And here you can decide the availability policy. This can be a standard or a spot. Spot usually is 3 times cheaper, but you need to be aware that the service can preemptively store or delete your capacity. And then this means that if you need a machine that needs to be 100% available 24/7, don't choose a spot. You check here, spot is practically 3 times cheaper than the standard one, but again, Google can terminate your machine at when they had a shortage of capacities. This is the four values. Maybe again you have a specific configuration that you need to apply, but again, in any case, you can change that after deploying the VM. You can just, again, only some cases you may need to shut down the server, and that's it. The book disks, you can choose here the operating system and also the version, the size of the main disks of your machine, and also you can just create this image from a custom image and a snapshot. This usually is done when you activate the backup services. Also, you can have different types of backups or the snapshots, so not in the call storage where it's long all data, but maybe you need it, you need something that you saved it time ago. And also you can attach an existing disk to this machine and access to that, no? In case that you need to share or you have some important information there on that disk. Here we take the default, it's just a try. Access scope. So if you want by default to provide access to the APIs that you have activated in your machine, so it's not you always can have access to a service account and access with these service accounts in your machine to the IP address. It's not you can activate here from this machine. It's depending what you are doing, it's a good practice access to all clouds APIs. You don't need to set up additional, but this is quite open. If your machine is compromised, it may It meet it could you can run into troubles if somebody is a hacker or a or somebody break into your server. So in this case, the full access and or even you can provide access to some custom services, for example, BigQuery or Google Cloud or Google Storage, sorry, or some other services that you have may have activated on your machine. In this case, also you can activate some entrance on the firewall. There is a default template that is applied to access via SSH and terminal server port, and also ICMP, the typical protocols to manage the server remotely. In any case, I will show you later on how to create a new ingress rule to access to your machine into an arbitrary port. What more, you can install monitoring and logging agents and also bug share options here, probably the most relevant Well, you can create additional interface, provide a host name to those interfaces, also a new. But again, all this stuff you can do it after the machine is deployed, case that you really need. Additional digs, security here later, we will see how to include a new created public key to access via SSH from your CND, from your CLI in Linux or in Windows. Management options as well, but this is again no need to configure all the details right now, as again you can change these basis on your need whenever you want. Just create here, it's gonna take some seconds, and now as you can see we had the machine already here available. We didn't change the name. You can edit, as I told you, and then some of the stuff are only available when the machine is stopped, so now that you can do it even when the machine is live, is running. You want to change, for example, the name. Exactly, to change the it must be stopped, some other stuff as well needs to be stopped. You have here labels, tags as well, just to be able to identify the machine quickly. So you want to access the machine, you can activate the console as well. We didn't do it, but again you can stop it, and no need even to stop it in that case. You can access via SSH with the SSH client integrated on the browser. Here is just deploying a script into your browser and configuring creating a SSH key on the fly and accessing the VM via SSH. You can do this, or you can simply access, as we will see later on, to your machine from your command line in my case is going to be Windows Subsystem Linux Debian. We will see how to do it from there. So now probably you need to configure, as this machine by default, you will see here we have two IP addresses, one internal and another external. Both of them are ephemeral. This means that the case that you reboot the machine, this IP address will change 100% sure, so you will lose this IP address. So in order to do this static, this has a cost in any case. You can go to VPC network, virtual private cloud, IP addresses. And you see here I had these two IP addresses, the internal and external of the machine I had already created, and this is the one that we just created. So you had internal and external, the internal are private addresses, the external are public address, IP version 4. So you want to create this static, you just click here, promote this IP address, static IP address, get a name and reserve. And then it will change, like you see here, from ephemeral to static. Okay, now the next step is to configure the CLI, gcloud CLI. We are, in this case, as I said, in a Windows Subsystem Linux. I will pass you later in the description of the video all these commands just to you be able to replicate in your local environment. Also all the documentation that you need, because it may change depending on the operating system that you use to access via SSH to your machine. So here again I had a Windows Subsystem Linux at Debian. So I just update the machine. These commands, as I said, if you have exactly the same environment that me, is fine. If not, take a look to the documentation later on, I will provide you. Here we install some packages we need. We active, we download the K-rings to from Debian. This is I already had done. We also update the etc apt source list, also had done. And finally, you just simply install the Google Cloud CLI. Once you have done that, you just execute gcloud init, and this will set up the parameters of your CLI. This is exactly the same that Google do for you when you click here in Activate Cloud Shell. This is the cloud integrated in your dashboard. But doing that, you get your gcloud CLI activated from your local computer. As you can see here, I already have my default profile. You have two choices: either reinitialize the default profile or create a new configuration. If you create a new configuration, you just provide a name, and the next of the step are going to be the same. So I will reinitialize my configuration. It doing some check. So now you choose the email address that you are going to use to it used to be the same that you used to log in your Google Cloud account. Here you choose the project, and yeah, here you can set up as well in my case, I have multiple projects, so I need to choose one, or you need to choose the one that you want to access to. And here you can define the area. You can take a look to your specific area. In my case, is you can use just Europe, best to A, which is my region, and this configure your Google Cloud CLI. Again, once you want to use the login, you can as well as the decide which profile inside your configuration you want to use. So you want to now you can execute gcloud, for example, app or compute, I don't know, compute, yeah, and help just to check if you have this correctly installed. And as you can see here, you have the help. And well, you can add this. So now we are going to set up a public pair of keys, public and private, to access to our new VM. So what you have to execute is, no, one second. You need to execute. Let me do a clear. Gonna be easy. A command like that. I will pass you as well the documentation because this may change depending on the operating system where you run the command. We are going to generate a pair of keys in with the protocol RSA. So in Debian Ubuntu, the SSH client come by default. So you just execute SSH hyphen K keying and hyphen T the protocol hyphen F the name of the keys. Usually, when you create a key, it's a good practice to save it in a folder with some restricted access. If you don't specify anything, here I already run the keying several times. So the first time you do it, you can just specify the name of the private key, and it will do the command, the SSH hyphen caching will do everything for you. In this case, just I'm pointing to the folder because it's already created. You don't need to create it again. It will do SSH caching for you, and then it will apply some restricted access rights, because there obviously you have your private keys. So I get a different name to the one I have already created, and hyphen C upper is the user name that you will include in your public key. This username used to be the email address that you used to log in your in your Google account, and then you need to change the hyphen with an underscore, and also the dot with an underscore. Later is doing a concatenation of a username at IP address of the host, and if you don't do this replacement, it will not be possible to, or the SSH client doesn't understand correctly the command, is not parsing it correctly. And Hyper-V is the size of the keys. So in this case, 2048. So don't use a public IP address, and then on you can now execute, you can take a look to the content of your public IP address you need to copy. So you can see here is the protocol, this is the public key, and this is the username. If you take a look to what you had in your SSH, you have no host. Here is just a file where it's keeping all the public IP address of the servers of the servers where this client is connecting to, and the different pairs of public private public IP address. Here you see my first one, VN Forensic Public, the 2 and the 3. So now we will add this public IP address to our server. So you just copy, and we go to our public IP address, computer engine, virtual instance. You click on it, edit, and you just scroll to SSH keys, and you can add here your key. Save, and copy your IP address, your external IP address, and now let me 1 second, I'm preparing Forensic 3. Okay, so now we return to the CLI, that one, and then just execute SSH hyphen E. The E is pointing to the private IP key, the private key. So the private key is on dot SSH / VN hyphen forensic hyphen 3. This is the public key that we just created here. And the user add public IP address of the VN that we want to connect to. Oops, 1 second. Oh yeah, 1 second. That happens because I already create a machine with this IP address before, and then now, oops, it changed. Let me open it, and they say that is the enter number 3. You can cut it. In fact, you can recreate all this file at your convenience, because the only thing that is gonna happen that the next time that you connect, it will save in that file the key again. So you just create connect again. Now it's saving, and we are already in the machine. Yeah, we had here unam-a. We are on the machine instance 24.05.23.21.42.16, which essentially is that one. Now, if you want to create, for example, use a FileZilla, let me close this connection. That is something I did before. Let's site manager, yes, GCP server. The IP address is gonna be that one. You just choose, for example, in this client key file. Here you can, and you choose the correct IP address. In that case, I have a Linux Debian /ssh to all files is the VM for NC3, and you just click connect. So here SFTP port 22, the public IP address, the user /gmail_com, and the public key that you have. Okay, and you have it there. So now you could move, I don't know, let's check here, you can go to the, repos, where I have repos here, so you can move whatever you want here, you can move it here. For example, let's do this one, we can move it here. It's gonna take a while. So you have it here, and if you go directly to your machine, you can check here that you have it, Gemini bot. That's it. Okay, that's all. This is the step one, the part one of this tutorial. We just simply install the infrastructure. Later on, we will move the software and configure a virtual environment. And finally, most likely, we will create a CI/CD pipeline using GitHub Actions in order to deploy automatically our code whenever we change it. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for watching my video. I hope you like it. In case that you like it, just give me a like and subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. And share with your friends and colleagues if you think that this can be also interesting for them. Thank you very much. Bye bye.